So great, I'm Lynda and I'm doing a presentation today called Colour and Sustainability Design for Change, and it's a parallel title to our book, Fashion and Sustainability Design for Change. But I decided, you know, sustainability is such a complex issue and, you know, it's unfolding all the time, or our understanding of it is evolving over time and becoming more mature in a way. And by focusing on just one aspect of what designers balance on a day-to-day basis, it allows me to sort of go a little sort of deeper and broader. And so that's what I'm aiming to do today, although of course you can't put everything into 20 minutes, so I'm looking forward to the discussion later as well. I'm not quite sure how to move it forward. Maybe it's that button.
Is it?
Yes. Okay. Well, in our book, we emphasize the and, the fashion and sustainability, because often fashion is presented as the antithesis of sustainability, and it doesn't have to be that way. And I like to start with a definition from Oxford English Dictionary for fashion: to give fashion or shape to form, mold, shape, either material or immaterial object. And I like this because our industry is uber focused on supply chain issues and material and processing. And with that sort of focus, which actually is a production function, actually misses the sort of immaterial aspects of fashion. So the sense of self that, for example, my 13-year-old daughter is exploring through her clothes now, or the sense of belonging that all of us explore, you know, the social coding that we explore through our clothing and with each other, are missed and often dismissed and can even be ridiculed, believe it or not, by environmentalists and by the conventional fashion industry. It's a short presentation, so I'm going to touch very lightly on these areas in terms of colour, but in the fashion industry, you know, cultural aspects and in design. But in the fashion industry, colour is the quickest, cheapest, most effective, fastest way to change a garment and to attract the attention of a customer and to attract money from their pocketbook, essentially, if you think of changing color versus fabric or the silhouette. We use it in the industry to sell more items, basically. We'll take one product and offer it in several colors so we can sell it several times, and we'll offer colorways for the same reason. In culture, we've got these color icons. If you take the little black dress, for example, it conjures up elegance, strength, sophistication, or Valentino's little red dress, supreme femininity and confidence of being able to carry that kind of intensity of color. And these are color icons that we have created ourselves. So fashion designers, we know these cultural references very well, past and present, and we pick up on the zeitgeist of the future. And then we have our own sensibilities and ways of looking at the world and pull inspiration from disparate sources. In this case, socks from an old Indian bazaar. Who would have thunk it, that it inspires a particular color direction for the season. And we pull this together to form a cohesive collection that balances all these disparate sources and creates cohesion and variety within one group. Working at different scales, all the way down to the tiny detail on a button and all the way up to what might for this collection be a bright blue raincoat on the collection, a singular piece, for example. So we're very used to working at multiple dimensions and at multiple scales, and we work fluidly always towards a positive outcome, balancing all of these things. So when I first was exposed to sustainability, I was working at a company called Esprit in San Francisco as a conventional designer. And the owner of the company, Doug Tompkins, was a big outdoors person, friends with Yvonne Chouinard from Patagonia. And they saw the outdoors being degraded by increased use and wanted to use their businesses for change. And so all of us were encouraged to look at ways that we could reduce the impact on the environment. At that time, we were looking at things like operations and water use and energy and so on. And by just being in the design room and being exposed to people like Paul Ehrlich, who was talking about population control, and Dave Foreman talking about wilderness, you know, really stretching to try and think, well, what does this have to do with getting the next spec sheet out to Hong Kong tomorrow? But really stretching and trying to apply things. And I knew straight from the beginning that we were a junior company. We're based in California. We had to have color right from the beginning. I mean, really, to be quite honest, the granola and the unbleached and the burlap sacks were never part of the conversation. They couldn't be for a company like Esprit. Color, you know, if we'd have had unbleached, undyed, or burlap sacks or whatever, they just wouldn't have sold, and our customers would have been very bored. So right from the beginning, we had to look at color issues. And I started quite naively by asking chemical dye companies if they could make natural dyes commercially viable, and I got zero responses, not understanding that those industries are the antithesis of each other. And then finally found the right language that gave a response that I could work with. And so the question as it formed was, how can we optimize the environmental performance of dyes and dye systems? And then I got a response from Siba Geigy and a gentleman called Nelson Hauser, and started to learn about water toxicity and energy in dye stuffs. And we landed with bifunctional reactive dyes, which all the dyes in the audience I'm sure will know about. With a higher fixation to the cloth, we were able to fix at something like 80% rather than 60%, which was typical on cotton, using a 4-to-1 liquor to fabric ratio when the typical at that time in industry was 12 and 20-to-1. So vastly reducing water volume, which then needed less energy to heat it. But we also used a cold pad batched dye system, which meant it operated at room temperature, so vastly reducing energy use. And so that's one approach to sustainability. You know, you take what you're doing, you tweak it a little bit, you improve upon it around a certain number of parameters. We also happen to use or disallow or choose to reject metal complexes, which in this particular dye stuff meant copper. And so we weren't able to use Kelly Green and turquoises. But there's no doubt in my mind that any designer in this room can work extremely well with a limited color palette and make it look absolutely fabulous. And so that's how we proceeded. That's how things looked for e-collection. And at the time, working in industry, and still now, the things that you're concerned with are the evenness of the dye stuff applied to the fabric, the repeatability from one batch to another, light and wash fastness over time, and crocking on the skin. And we achieved all of those things. For e-collections line, any of the synthetic dyes were that dye process. But we also used some natural dyes, recycled wool, which had the color from the previous life, and naturally colored cotton. So there were, you know, many approaches to color. But you can see that the look of the garments was very similar to what Esprit was doing at that time. It's a little different now. But at that time, it was very similar. We had a very tight circle of style that we had to work within. And even now, the most progressive companies will say that any acts of sustainability need to be invisible. And there can't be any compromise of desirability to the consumer. And I'm particularly interested in an aesthetic that emerges when you embrace sustainability as a core value. But I'll circle back to that notion of desirability in the consumer, because who decides what's desirable and why is critical for sustainability. So since leaving Esprit, I've worked in, you know, a number of sectors, still continuing to work in the private industry, whittling away, you know, educating, and in this case, working with A2 Artisans, a non-profit organization, and here shown in rural Kyrgyzstan. And when you're working in this kind of environment, the goals and the use of color are pretty much the same. You're using color to increase sales, but with the profits in this case coming back to the artisans or the artisan group. And you can see we're doing colorways, the methodologies that we're using, colorways here with the pillars so we can sell more. But when you're working in this kind of an environment, it's a very rudimentary dye system, and the benefits and the impacts are seen firsthand. And the artisans would buy powder from the local bazaar, And it's unlabeled. There's no material safety data sheet. There's not even a content sheet. And bring them back, and then dye in their rural setting, wring out the felt, and tip their dye baths out in their backyards, right there next to their beets and potatoes. And so I found this quite alarming, because if we're increasing the sales to the artisans, then we're also increasing the volume and the impact of this. And they thought it was quite funny that I was concerned. But we started working with a natural dye woman, Michelle Whiplinger from Seattle, and there's a natural dye's fleece laid out for allergies over there on the right. But then using natural dyes opened up a whole other line of inquiry. Of course, you know, where were the natural dye extracts going to come from? Were we going to make the artisans dependent on an outside source where they couldn't control delivery or price? Could we therefore source natural dyes locally? What plants were available? When what colours would they yield? During what times of the year? Could we hook the artisans with importers that would tolerate a disrupted delivery? So all of these, you can see how sustainability really compels us to ask deeper and deeper questions. And it's really a form of unfolding, going from product to processes to the context in which those processes are used, to the region, to nature itself, because ultimately, in the end, it's nature's capacity to supply the raw materials for our industrial and creative processes, and her tolerance of being able to carry away wastes that ultimately decides what is and is not sustainable. So I'm going to take pause a little bit. You'll see some similar images, but a slightly different take on cotton to what you saw in the first presentation, because it was one of my first entry points, cotton, to sustainability. It was 90% of Esprit's business at the time, and it was 60% in those days of global textile production. It's been taken over by far by polyester more recently. But it's not the detail of its cultivation that I want to focus on today. It's more using cotton as an analogy for a mindset that's prevalent in our industry and in our culture. Because the cotton industry is definitely reading all the signs that we are. We've got increased population, increased wealth, and therefore increased consumption. We've already got declining resources, and the allocation of those resources is going to become increasingly contentious, if not ethical, as it already is in some places. And the cotton industry has got the message that it has to do more with less. And that's translating into yielding more per acre. I live in California, and I've worked with California cotton farmers for quite some time, helping them to transition to biological systems. And California is one of the most productive cotton production systems on the planet. We've had access to the best available technology for decades. It's a capital-intensive system. We apply chemicals by land and by air with, very powerful technology. We've had genetic modification since it was introduced in 1996. And water, which is very expensive in California, forces farmers to literally laser level the land so that this expensive water can flow efficiently from one end of the field to the other. And this combined technology has enabled yields of 3.5 bales an acre. Even more, last year it was 4 and even more than 4 bales an acre, which is 3 to 4 times greater than your average smallholder farmer in India or even in Texas where they dry farm. So it's an incredible feat of human ingenuity, and you have PhD scientists working on this continuously, very proud of the productivity that we're able to achieve. And yet farmers are struggling to stay on the land. And these regions, though they're agriculturally very productive, they're impoverished. There's 25% unemployment in the agricultural counties around Fresno. There's 40% of children live in poverty. The average income is about $18,000. So it's an extractive economy. It's an extractive industry. And my point that I'm making here is that when we're looking at sustainability issues, we can't just look at technology in isolation. We've got to be looking at these broader issues: who benefits and what's our intention in what we're doing. And then more to the point, you heard this factoid earlier. In the US, 68 pounds of clothing a year are thrown away by the average consumer. But if you look at any consumer area, the details or the number is not that different in England, for example, either. And that's about 34 pairs of jeans, just to give you an idea. And that's an average, so someone somewhere is throwing away a lot more. So, you know, when you're exposed, when you bear witness to the massive mobilization of natural resources on one hand for commerce and the enormous waste on the other, you can't help as a designer reflect on your own practice and the logic of producing, yielding, and even designing more. You know, what is it that makes our industry and consumers work this way? Or behave this way, I should say. Well, it's really difficult as a designer to sort of grapple with these issues. Typically, we work inside companies. We don't have the power. It's usually the fashion, the CEOs and the money people that have the power to make actually big strategic decisions that are going to impact this kind of issue that we have to tackle. We're typically, I call, sequestered in a design studio. We're looking towards the market, looking at trends, our competition, and so on. We might go back up the supply chain a little bit if we're working in textiles, but typically we're directed by marketing. And when that direction is any acts of sustainability need to be invisible, you typically get something like this changed to something like this. And it's obviously inadequate to the challenges that we have. So what we suggest, both in the book and just in generally, is that designers step out of that studio and interact with across disciplines, with all kinds of people, develop the confidence and economic literacy to work alongside CEOs, but also with anthropologists, new economists, really look at new ways of doing things. And last but not least, where are collaborators? Because consumers have only got two choices, to buy or not to buy a garment. And as designers, our success is measured by the number of units our designs sell. But as wearer collaborators, people have many opportunities to interact and explore sustainability through fashion, and likewise, we've got many opportunities to engage with them too. So in the book, we suggest that designers step into new roles as facilitators, educator, communicators, activists, entrepreneurs. And here's just a couple of examples. When I hear, for example, that natural dyes are not commercially viable because they dye unevenly, my background, it happens to be as a knitwear designer, so I think in terms of yarns. And then I say, well, why don't we dye yarns deliberately unevenly and knit them up, and it'll create something really wonderful. And okay, it's not solid, but you could, you know, it's a different aesthetic, but you could argue that it's actually a more valuable aesthetic. There are many, many, you know, creative solutions to a technical problem. This is a designer, Ashley Brock, who graduated last year. And this is a result of working with scientists and technologists that Levi's, who are responsible for water quality globally and are very concerned about allocation of freshwater resources and looking at things like desalination plants and so on to get more fresh water. And she felt that in her dye process, she adds salt to the dye bath. And so she used actually ocean water in her process and did a beautiful collection, suggesting that there are more poetic entries to dealing with sustainability, again, not just the brute force of technology, but working with nature as well. A lovely collection, completely dye fast or color fast. So, and again, this can come back to influence industry in a sort of gentle way. My colleague, Sasha DeWare, has an organization called Permacouture, and she talks about losing the culture of color, that we're no longer aware of what colors we wear in season and how that might have available to us in season, and you know, from how that might vary from Nova Scotia to Northern California, for example. And what she does is connect with local chefs, and they do these dinners to die for. And they invite people to have a sumptuous dinner with local ingredients, and they use those ingredients also to dye a piece of clothing or an article that people have brought. In this case, they had fennel for dinner and then used the fennel to dye a felt fleece that they hung against the back wall as a backdrop. So by piggybacking on a behavior that's already occurred, she's suggesting that people, besides eating food in season and locally, do the same with color and clothing. I know I'm running over. I'm just going to keep going. Is that okay? Another colleague, Mimi Robinson. Oh, I should say, I'm getting a bit nervous because of time, that with Sasha's work, what she's doing is she's opening people's minds up to the possibility of engaging with colour in the same way that they've now engaged with food. So with Mimi Robinson, I met her through working with A2 Artisans. Mimi continues this good work. And in this particular case, in Guatemala. And she would never go into a particular area with a Pantone color book and ask them to match Pantone number 5671. What she talks about, rather, is coming into the area and opening herself up to the colors that are around and exist in that culture. And in this case, being inspired by a graveyard, of all things, to develop the yarns. So again, it's an opening up process. And then lastly, local wisdom. You know, Kate will talk a little bit about this, and it's her latest research project, unless she's started many more since, and that's, knowing Kate, she probably has. But I've had the honor of leading that investigation in San Francisco, which invites volunteer members of the public to bring garments and talk about what Kate has coined as the craft of use. And there's so many stories, people who wear things upside down or have never washed their garments, or you just have to go to the website localwisdom.info to be thoroughly inspired. But this lady is from the House of Lords, and she talked about a really dear friend that she'd had since childhood, and this friend wore colour top to toe, just really vibrant, very confident woman. And this top was given to her by this dear friend, and she wears it. And of course she thinks of the friend, but she also feels that she's got a little bit of the confidence of the woman that she's now has for herself. So it's these, again, these immaterial aspects of fashion, these connections that we have, how we relate and communicate with each other, you know, through fashion and clothing, are just, you know, wonderful examples, completely new territory for us to explore, because again, they're completely ignored by the regular fashion industry. So just closing up and revisiting those norms again, that little black dress, it takes about 9, 10, 12, maybe 14 dips to get a really good commercial black, and that's a lot of water and energy in a time of peak water and peak oil. So maybe we can revisit this again, you know, maybe as educators we can write an additional chapter in the little black dress book, and it's called The Little Grey Dress, that's appropriate for our time. Valentino's red, that red color, it's one of the most fugitive colors that we have, and it takes a lot of washing and rinsing to get that excess color off the cloth so it doesn't crock on the skin. Maybe we can engage with emergent and existing technologies and reuse dye baths, so that every time we use red, we've also got a tonal pinks that run through the collection, start to change things visually. Better Brand is a company in San Francisco. It's an online-only company, although they've just opened a small retail store. But they sell to individuals. They often crowdsource first so that they know that they're going to sell their stuff. They produce what they've already sold, in a sense, so they've got no inventory waste and no post-sales waste. But for the purpose of this presentation, Stephen on the left doesn't mind if his grey top is a commercial match with Joe's on the right. You know, so our industrial norms that we have for colour, we need to revisit them also in light of these new business models that are enabled through new technology. The book What's Mine Is Yours by Rachel Bosman documents a very strong movement in the sharing economy and collaborative consumption. And again, if these people that are selling their garments online and through eBay or whatever it might be, does this garment need to be a repeat colour? Does it need to be accurately in a repeat sense? Probably not. But does it need to be light and wash fast over time? Probably does, if we're going to design it to be shared and be in circulation for longer. So these norms, they warrant revisiting. They won't necessarily be shifted, but they definitely need a recalibration. So just in closing, this is where the industry is now, looking at products and processes, and there's a lot of work to be done, and you know, it's dirty work, and we're glad someone's doing it. But we've really got to be looking at behavior, why the industry, why designers, why consumers behave the way they do, and to really take hold of that, we've got to be thinking about sustainable society and culture, because that's where the direction for the behavior comes from. And so we're looking to move from this kind of an approach to fashion and sustainability to a pluralistic aesthetic that emerges from all kinds of unusual places, from the global south as much as it does the developed north, from everyday people as much as it does from designers or experts or scientists, from new business models, from questioning cultural, social, industrial norms, and from shared experiences and local capacities and abilities. And I will end with that. Thank you.